The history of the car itself, as an example, the history of Volkswagen models with the VW Beetle, the Golf 1 and the future, the Volkswagen ID. And I'm joined here today by Klaus Bischoff, head of Volkswagen Design. And we will talk about the different stages of automotive evolution and, of course, with a design focus. So first of all, thanks for having us here. And maybe you can tell us, just as a first introduction, how do you see how cars have evolved over time with those three models next to each other?
Yeah, it has been a great journey, I think. And Volkswagen's aim was always to come up with a product that is made for the masses, for the people, so the people's car, to come up with something that is highly functional, and of course from the design standpoint, iconic and outstanding, characterful, and that's what we are after.
And now let's dig into the details. We'll start with the oldest one. It's all today an Autogefühl, your number one resource for in-depth car reviews and your number one community to discuss cars. Where's Thomas? Now in full screen, full HD and full X. Let's go. The story of the Volkswagen Beetle, or Käfer as we say in Germany, started in 1933, and this one here is from 1958 and designed by Ferdinand Porsche himself. And well, you are basically the successor, and you can tell maybe what was the most important design aspect of this time, and also considering the new Volkswagen ID we already see here, there's no front air intake because the engine is in the rear. And what does that mean for the Volkswagen design?
For us that is highly important because the brand was born without a grille. So with the ID we are coming back to this identity and to the friendliness and to the sympathetic brand values that Volkswagen definitely has. And that's what we want to point out with our new design approach. So in a way we do find back to our roots. Yeah, also from the functional standpoint, the engine is in the back, you have a trunk in the front and a relatively huge interior space that you offer the customers in this unique package. And there are similarities to our most modern concept that we feature now with the ID.
What's your most likable feature, for just personal, at the Käfer?
Yeah, of course, I do love the Käfer, and for me, it's a very emotional product that everybody loves. And when you are on the motorway or in a city with an old Käfer, of course, everybody's looking and smiling. Yeah, so it's a super sign for sympathy. And the face and the facial expression, the open eyes, the sympathetic approach of the product, and that you are in love with it immediately is the asset of and the feature of the Beetle, or the Käfer.
From the Beetle, Volkswagen sold over 20 million copies over time, and maybe you can explain us how was the design laid out in the rear, because that's obviously totally different than cars we see today.
Yeah, absolutely. The boxer engine, a flat four, was packaged in the back, very short, and that led to this unique buck shape, yeah, as we call it. So this fluent lines, yeah, the elegance of the fenders were defined also by the package, and that's what it's all about. You need to get proportions and package right to come up with something that is unique.
You've also studied industrial design. Did this design here also influence your personal career?
Of course it does. My first car was a Beetle, so. And I always dreamt of being a car designer. And if you work in car design, you have to understand technology and packaging, and you need to know a lot to design cars. And that's very interesting. So I have a dream job.
Let's take a short look into the interior. So this interior here corresponds to the exterior, and for a while you were also responsible just for interior design at Volkswagen. And how did this one inspire you, and what's the most special thing about this interior for you?
I think the most special aspect of the Beetle interior, it's the simplicity that you see. So the aim, of course, was to get the cost down to make mobility accessible for everyone. To create that, the design features only what is absolutely a necessity or given by law. And in the most simple way, the interior defines that, and from my point of view, in a very characterful and valuable way. You have a nice steering wheel, a central instrument, and it's all neatly packaged, yeah, and you have plenty of room in comparison to other products at that point of time. And I think Dr. Porsche did a fantastic job on that one.
Some viewers might wonder that they don't see a Volkswagen logo on the top of the steering wheel. We will see later on also with the Golf 1. Maybe you can explain us, what is this logo here we see on the steering wheel?
That is the Wolfsburg, and it's a sign for where we are today here in Wolfsburg in the factory, and of course a sign of heritage where the Käfer belongs to. And at that point of time, the brand logo was only on the top of the bonnet, and from my point of view, a very decent way to put it.
The next icon we have here is the first generation Golf, introduced in 1974. And this very car we see here is from 1980, and of course, maybe in a better shape than it ever was before. And we see a completely different design, and I think this also reflects the automotive evolution and the current society at that time.
Yeah, absolutely. If you imagine at what point of time this car was born, we see the age of computers coming. Safety was a big issue. People wanted more room. Traveling, motoring was really public at that time and popular. So everybody wanted more, and the Käfer started to descend. Yeah, and Volkswagen was at that point of time, in a situation where they really had to think about, okay, what do we do? What do we offer? And in a way, disruptive. The decision was taken to come out with a completely new concept with a lot of advantages for the customer. So the engine went from the back to the front. Yeah, the trunk was enlarged. The interior was enlarged. The footprint, not so much. So under the line, the advantage of a front front wheel transmission was taken into account, and here comes the future at that point of time. And this concept was so neatly designed, so clearly designed by Giugiaro, that Volkswagen was back on the path of success.
And this really led to an even bigger success than with the Beetle, because here we also had over 30 million units sold so far, and it's of course still continuing. And taking a look at the rear and the side profile, the most iconic part of the Golf that has been carried out over the generations, you will also find a special Golf Generations feature here on Autogefühl, is actually the C-pillar. What's the most special part about the C-pillar here, and how has it been carried out over time?
Yeah, Giugiaro designed this piece, and for me it's a masterpiece, because it's a super sign for simplicity again. And simplicity lies in the proportion, and lies in the only few elements that you need to design a car, if everything else is right. So proportion right, functionality right, then you only need few lines. And that is important to understand. The feature that defines the Golf the most is the C-post. And the C-post shows a strong, characterful backbone. It shows you are protected. The car is very solid. And this element was from the beginning so strong that we were able to develop it and evolutionize it over time. So you're gonna find this in every generation of Golf, and I promise also in the future.
So we see a little bit less of simplicity here in the Golf 1 interior. Why is that? And what was the intention behind this concept?
Yeah, of course, functionality has grown over time. So in the interior, you see more functionality. You see a climate control, you see a stereo system, you have air vents. All that has grown over time. Yeah, so more functionality leads to more complication. But I would say, in comparison to other products at that point of time, the Golf was a pretty clean design, yeah? Maybe not as simple as a Käfer, but clean. And the aim at that point of time was to create the biggest interior space in the class, to create a comfortable package, yeah, with nice seats and a decent ride quality, huge trunk, and a lot of safety features at that point of time protected the occupants. So from my point of view, it was the class leading, or the class defining design, the Golf.
And now to the future, to the fully electric vehicle, supposed to have a range between 400 and 600 kilometers, and coming up in 2020, the Volkswagen ID. And of course, a big part of that is the design that is aligned with the autonomous driving function. And this is also your very own project. So what do you think about when designing the front, and how was it inspired by the things we saw earlier today?
Of course, it's all based on the brand values, and simplicity, purity, sympathy are typical Volkswagen brand values. And we try to bring them now into the future with this new iconic face. The eyes and the logo, the Volkswagen brand logo, are forming a unit now, but it's an interactive one. Why is that? That is important to understand that in the future cars are driving autonomous. So they're moving from A to B, and you maybe sleep inside, or you read the newspaper, or you're doing something on your smartphone, or
watching Autogefühl.
Or watching Autogefühl, yeah, getting the latest news from Autogefühl. And So the car is taking over, and communication between the other people that are traveling. Yeah,
you can see it also right here at the moment.
In an example here, if a pedestrian is recognized and the car stops, and so the car gives you now an indication, okay, now you might walk, and the car is looking at the surroundings and is also warning people if something hazardous is coming up. So that is important, that the eyes, that the face is getting interactive now, and that's our aim.
By the way, should some of the lights be flickering, that's just on camera, they are not in real life. And we see there's a special LED light signature, however, so many cars have special light signatures. That's when the car says, you know, that is everything is too close.
Yeah. Be careful.
but as more and more cars also have an LED light signature, you try to create something else with light, with the logo.
Yeah, of course, roads are getting crowded with LED signatures, and everybody shouts out, oh, here I am, and I'm from a certain brand. So we want to give this a friendliness, first of all, and a sympathetic approach. But for us, it's also important to state that the brand logo and the lights are giving Volkswagen a new identity. And important to recognize that now we are back to our roots. So we were born without a grill, and we are coming back to a design where you don't see any grill in the front. And this leads to a design that is very characterful and that stands out in the market.
It's not sure yet if this one will be allowed, this light. Probably when standing still, yes. When driving, Volkswagen will have to check with regulations. Looking at the side profile, what I find remarkable that all the three cars we have here today, although they're decades in between, they don't differ that much in length. So here also we were just, I think it was 416. So this car is shorter than a Golf, but will have more space on the inside. And I think that has something to do with the design of electric vehicles, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Now the energy, so the battery is like a big part of the platform. It's a flat unit that sits between the wheels. And the engine is, again, in the back, like it was in the Käfer. So the weight distribution is perfect. You have a low center of gravity, so driving definitely will be fun. But, you know, Volkswagen is about functionality and packaging, and to come up with a concept that is well thought out, and that's what you see here. So the wheels have been moved to the outmost points that are allowed, and that leads to a very, very large interior. So we feature the interior space of a Passat on a footprint that is smaller than a Golf. And that's what I would call a customer advantage.
In the rear, we can see that I think you have somehow combined the Golf and the Beetle, because we have more rounder shapes again, not so much angular shapes. But at the same time, also the width is stressed by the tail lights. So what was your aim in designing the rear, and what are the most iconic points for you?
Aerodynamics are truly important on electric-driven cars. So what you see here is also defined by technology, by the wind channel, to a good portion. And our aim was to do something that has a nice stance on the road, that has a very characterful presence, and that's what our light signatures in the back are doing. And also they do fulfill functional aspects, so communication again is essential. And we defined a design with only a few lines. So this line that leads around the black part is one line. We have another line that is circulating around the body, and we have another line that is defined by the platform, the battery. And that's it from the design standpoint. So three major lines, only few graphical elements, lead to simplicity, to a very unique approach that stands out in the automotive world.
And now the most spectacular part about this car is the interior, and also how do you approach the interior. Does it have also something to do with imitating a living being?
Yeah, a little bit, of course, yeah. But the car has a lot of new features, so it immediately recognizes that I'm coming. And you see the car is offering the handle, yeah, it's neatly integrated due to aerodynamic reasons, of course. We have a very wide 90 degree opening to giving access to the car. And we have a B-pillar-less design, so when the car is fully opened, you have really a huge, huge interior.
We can also open the rear door, which is has a very nice effect as well. So this is what you used to call suicide doors, basically, but now it's fashionable again.
Yeah, now this is a new door system that we call a hinge door. Yeah, you have a double parallelogram arm that has no connection to the body in the top, and has a very little room for maneuver, and gives access in a large way to the back of the car.
What can you tell us about the new human-machine interface? What's special here?
We are featuring in the ID two major items, two main major features. First of all, now I'm in the manual mode. I'm driving the car actively. If I want to hand it over to automatic driving, I have to place my hand on it, and the car is taking over, and the steering wheel is integrated into the dashboard. So I have now more room to sit comfortably, and I can either sleep or read, or I can watch Autogefühl on my tablet computer.
Excellent. And one special feature is also the new head-up display that is also different from the current systems we see so far. What's the special function?
It's an augmented reality, HUD. So what does it mean? It gives you the information displayed virtually on the road. So arrows that lead you to your destination are displayed on the road 15 meters ahead of you in a large picture. And that's definitely something new, and that allows us to clean up the interior. So natural speech is the way to communicate. You only have a few switches, and they all touch devices. So literally, you don't have any mechanic elements in the interior. And that leads to what we call open space, a very lounge, an atmosphere that is loungy, so to speak. And that's what we wanted to create. If you're in autonomous mode, you're feeling more like at home. You are not disturbed by technical elements, and you have a new sensation of driving.
Thank you very much for your time. And maybe it's the last question for today. You had so much effort designing this car. How close can you say does it really come to the real model later? Can you give us some prospect?
Of course, our aim is to bring this as it is into reality. But that is at this point of time not possible, as we are featuring some technical elements that are in pre-development. So when the car comes to market, you might see the one or the other element you will recognize, others not. But I would say 85% we bring this car to the marketplace like it is.
Thank you very much, and of course we'll keep you updated by that.
Bye-bye.
Edwin, I wanted to compare directly after each other is how much space do we have for luggage and also for the people. And this is what you have for luggage in the Beetle. You see, this is very limited. Of course, the trunk here, stylishly in the front, very, very close to the front fender. The room here in the front is limited by the huge steering wheel, but you needed those large steering wheels at the time because you didn't have any electronic help. So you had a bigger diameter to really be able to steer the car around. Headroom is plentiful, and I mean, you see the car is still high, but overall, it's not the most spacious feeling here. And if you think about that, you know, the generations before me went to Italy too with that car, maybe really long, long runs. I have to say, respect to that. And look at the length of the antenna and just remember that when we move on to the Volkswagen ID. This is a remarkable thing. And what about the length here in the rear compartment? I just try to fit in here. It's almost an exercise. Let's see if that works. And well, not really. Maybe like this. You see, this had to be improved over time because for tall people, well, headroom wise, it's not a problem, but legroom wise. And how much room do we have in the Golf 1? By the way, here, this iconic door handle where you press the back part and then open the door. And then let's get inside. Again, the steering wheel is already a little bit smaller, but still I have some problems to get in, you know, with my legs. Headroom is a little bit shorter, also for aerodynamic reasons then. And, well, itself here, the cockpit in the front is a little bit roomier than we have seen in the Beetle. And of course, the modern gauges, that is a big difference. And also the seats already allow you a rather more upright position. And the rear, this was of course a major change, for example with the doors. And there's not too much space here either. Maybe when you put the seat a little bit more straight, the front seat, then it would work. So it's already an improvement and was very important at the time. Headroom wise, a little step back, and I'm 1.86 meters or 6'1" that you can really compare it. What about the trunk here? This was a huge difference. You see, and this was already room enough for family luggage and, for example, also for the daily groceries, and also easier to open than the front trunk. And let's get inside here. And this is an easy entry because also the steering wheel is really small and, well, has this flattened end and or the bottom part that is really good for getting the legs inside. And headroom wise, still plenty of space with this panoramic glass roof. And the really crucial thing is that it is so spacious in here because we have gotten rid of all of the instruments, and especially if you look to the co-driver side. And we've seen it earlier, especially when we're in the autonomous drive mode. We have really a lot of space when the steering wheel is even drawn back. So this lounge concept really changes the feeling you have inside the car. And of course also the seats, they are electronically adjustable in many ways, as we also know from other modern cars. And then we have also those LED light shows that we haven't seen before. And in the rear, this is also a funny concept because first of all, we can also flip up the seats, and we know this also from other manufacturers. Honda has introduced this so-called magic seats in a lot of their cars. This is a similar concept, but we can also, for example, put a plant in here, for example, to transport higher stuff inside. So this is also a new possibility then. And now the most crucial part is that because we have this electric vehicle concept, we have also more space on the inside, and especially here for the knees. And if you think about a car that is usually, you know, from a length of a Polo, for example, or at least below a Golf, here I do have more knee room. That is the most important point here. And although the car is relatively flat, it still works with taller adults in the rear. However, I could imagine that the real car of the Volkswagen ID might also be a little bit higher even, because concept cars are usually also flatter, wider, have bigger wheels and no mirrors and those other things that are quite often then changed in the real versions. And the rear compartment here also with the illuminated VW logo. Still the mechanism we know from the Golf, for example. And we do lose height as the batteries are also placed in the bottom of the car, but then we don't lose anything in the other dimensions. And with this concept car, the seats cannot be flipped, but this will surely be the case in the real version, that you can also fold the seats flat down. Then you will also have even more space. So I really hope you enjoyed this trip through time with us. It has been a very interesting journey about functionality, technology, and of course design. And what I find the most interesting aspect is that this car design we've seen through the decades has also been reflecting always, you know, what's up to date at the common, at the given stage of time. And this also leads to the old design mantra, form follows function. Then give us your thoughts on the different cars. Which one is your favorite? And thank you very much for watching this episode of Autogefühl. Tune in next time.